We have got some Latin American energy in the house. Now, yes. Recently moved to Europe and generally on a plane, I'm pretty sure.
That's it. Good morning, everyone. Bom dia. Let's rehearse the Portuguese here.
Well, beautiful. Hello, keep it international because it's going to be a really international conversation that we have. And Fabrizio, let's just paint the picture for everyone in the room who thinks, ah, I know Prosus. They're the biggest shareholder in Tencent. Mm-hmm. You are so much more than that. You have so many more investments than that. You are touching, what, 2 billion consumers. And I put it to you first and foremost, how are you using generative AI?
Hello, everyone. First, I'm super happy to be running Prosus because we don't do generative AI only in California or in China. Actually, we have operations in all Latin America, in Europe, in Central and Eastern Europe, in Africa, a lot of things in India. And we are using generative AI for everything. We are running, we have more than 100 companies. We are running many of our companies completely using AI to personalization, to save costs, to customer support, to reduce fraud, to process content from the users. We really run many of our companies using AI today.
You've actually built your own chatbot, right, as well, that your employees are using. How is that going? Plus one, right?
Yes, we call it Token. The first thing we did on generative AI in our company is to say everyone inside the company has to use it every day. We have 30,000 people in Prosus, just in our direct companies, and a few hundred thousand people outside in our investment companies. And we have a tool in our Slack that everyone has to use AI daily, has to use AI to translate something, summarize something. We give access to our internal documents and to our database through AI. So we can just, for example, in a food delivery business, ask our assistant, our internal assistant called Token, how many orders were delivered yesterday in São Paulo at afternoon? And you can just ask in natural language and get access to your database. And for us, this is very important that every company should be doing that. Because if I have 30,000 people that has to implement AI services to our 2 billion customers, the first thing they should do is to use every day and really understand the benefits, really understand how they can be more productive and live better using AI.
Okay, that's a really interesting point. And I actually want to go to our poll right now because I'm going to shift it forward because this is exactly the right moment to ask you and the audience what you think. Because this is a conversation about building trust in AI. And I wonder whether it's actually using it that really helps build our trust in AI. So do you think trust in AI will be built through consumer use and value or your employees' use and value? Do you think it'll be education, understanding about generative AI that builds your trust in it? Or do you think that it'll be regulation that ends up making you trust generative AI that little bit more? So we'll wait for that to populate as we go. But what made you think, I mean, to you, Fabrizio, has trust in generative AI been built in your employees through just using it? Or did you need to educate them first before they trusted it?
I think the big way to do that is using, seeing the benefits and understanding more. There is a lot of discussion today is let's avoid AI because it's dangerous. It's important to reinforce to you, it's a disruptive tool as important as the smartphone or the browser or the search in the internet. Is it possible to tell to your employees or to your students, do not work or do not study using a web browser or a smartphone or a 5G network? It's the same thing with AI. Everything will be using AI in 5 years. The photographer there, their camera is going to use AI in 5 years, and our sound system and the lights and everything that we do. But more important than that, and I think that's what we should be talking in the media, so I'm happy I'm here in Bloomberg repeating that. The benefit and the positive impact, it's so big. I'm from Brazil. My family's from a small city in Brazil. If we can offer the best healthcare advice in a small 10,000 people city in Brazil, can we decide not to do it? I think it's our obligation to offer the best healthcare, the same quality we can offer here in London to a small 10,000 people city in Brazil, as we have to offer those students in that city the best education possible. Or the companies, not only in Silicon Valley, but in Europe, but in Latin America, can they afford not to be efficient running the best services?
Right.
So the impact of AI is so big and so disruptive. I'm not talking about, people sometimes talk about AI as like as a magic, it's a magical thing that think by themselves and is going to conquer the world. AI is a tool that we are using to serve 2 billion customers today. The best way to trust them is to understand them, understand AI. And that's why Prosus, some of you doesn't know Prosus, but we have 100 companies in many countries all around the world. So we have developers in AI in São Paulo, but also in Hungary, in Poland, in South Africa, lots of developers in AI in India. And I think every country around the world, they cannot survive without saying, I have people that understand it, and I can build my future through this technology. Otherwise, during the Industrial Revolution, many countries were outside or later on that, and they lost a lot of space.
Yeah.
And what we need now, and I think that's an important space for Prosus, is to invest in AI locally in all those countries.
We're looking at people agreeing with you that ultimately it's about using it and learning it that builds trust.
Good.
But let's just go back to the emerging markets. Maybe it's because we sit in the developed nations that we can afford to spend our time having AI ethical debates and events and security meetings. I mean, goodness, the United Nations has just shone a light on the fact that they're throughout all these AI regulation and ethical debates, it's largely just been 7 nations that have been at all of these, whether it's been in the UK, whether it's been in Korea, and 180 more than countries have never had part of that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're sat in Brazil, South Africa, in Poland, are people worrying about the ethical debates on AI, about trust in AI? Are they just wondering when they can get their hands on it?
I think everyone is dreaming how we can use more and move faster, because the economic opportunity to countries that need development, need education, need health, it's so big that using tools to move faster is what everyone needs.
You think you need that, but are the people, the consumers you serve, do they realize that?
I think what we as managers of business have to do is to offer AI to customers. We are not talking about AI itself. We are talking about better customer support, faster delivery, cheaper delivery. If you can we have a big food delivery operation in many countries, in 70 countries in the world. Can we make the restaurants sell more and the customer buy cheaper food and receive it faster? Can we pay better the delivery driver? That's what AI is for, is to make the companies operate better. We're not saying, look, that is a robot, congratulations, the robot wants to talk to you. But we are making 5 million deliveries per day, where we can make sure that the quality and the cost of the delivery is smaller, what means more business to everyone, better service to everyone. That's the impact of AI, make business operate better, make customers be better served.
You're measuring that, as in those 5 million deliveries. Are you able to put a return on AI investment yet for Prosus?
Yeah, we just published, I think last week, 5 cases in iFoods, in OLX, another company of us, and PayU, showing
iFoods you founded. It's a Brazilian delivery company.
Yeah, exactly. So we just published many cases showing our ad revenues, ad costs went down like 30%. Our customer support now is 60%. Done by AI with 40% less costs. There is more like 10 numbers there. On OLX, a big classified, from every 100 million content submitted to that, 91% is approved by an AI system. So we just published many data. Hope I didn't mix any of the numbers. But go to our website, we publish many data because we want to demystify. AI is not like a magic robot. It's a tool that can make companies and companies run better.
Is Everett getting it wrong? How much hallucination is there? How much have you had to work on your own internal large language models or way in which you're adopting a large language model to ensure that the error decreases?
I love this question because it's not magic. So it's not like you just say, I'm using AI, or many people, I'm going to invest $1 billion in AI and things work. You need very good engineers, you need a lot of training, you need iteration. I love the lean startup idea that you have to put something up and then create a new model and then train it again and again and again. So I think we are very good on that, not because the CEO said, I like AI, but because we have 10,000 tech people every day making it better.
So which large language model did you use out of interest? Did you build your own or did you adopt?
We use everything.
All of them.
Everything. We have a big thing with OpenAI. So for example, another case we talked about last week, it's using the new real-time API that you can just talk as you are talking with a human. So it's like you just talk and you interrupt. And we are using that, for example, again in Brazil, to give support to drivers. So they can be driving, and instead of stopping to write, they can just talk and say, am I late? How do I correct my route? Or send some message. And they are talking to AI operator by voice on their mobile phone. So we use OpenAI a lot, but our position as Prosus, because we run in so many countries, like, as I said, India and now around in Europe, we made our token, our middleware for AI, to be connected to all the suppliers, so you can always not only test, but benchmark and select what we are going to use in each country, in each requirement.
I'm going to ask a cruel question. You, of course, are known for investments in China. Are the large language models being developed in China better than the ones in the US? Are they worse?
Oh my
God. Can you rate them for us?
You know this U.S. thing of competing against China? I don't get this U.S. Way of mood. Look, we are a big shareholder. We have 25% of Tencent. That is the biggest internet company in China. And Tencent is the company with the biggest number of AI patents in the world. So Chinese are also moving very fast on AI. And I think California are moving very fast in AI. I love both, so don't put me on this position. But what I want to remember is that besides China and US, we have 35 companies in India, and we are investing a lot in AI in India. For example, we have a food delivery business in India, Swiggy, or an e-commerce big business in India like Meesho, that are doing food delivery and e-commerce in ways that can only operate in India. It has to be cheaper. You cannot just take the California model and launch it in India. So you need AI. You need the best tools. For example, in Meesho, we were talking those days about customer support. They have millions and millions of customers, and it has to be very cheap to support all these customers with quality and speed. So we are using AI a lot in food delivery and e-commerce in India. And we have the same thing in Hungary or in South Africa or in Brazil. So I think California and Beijing, they are well served. They have billions of investments in AI. But Africa, Latin America, and India need more investments. I will be a little polemic. I think Europe needs more investment too, and that's why Prosus is here. We need to invest much more because the whole world needs to master these new tools.
Will you invest ahead of regulation being written and with regulation already written in Europe? What do you think about it?
Invest ahead of regulation. We only do legal things, so we're not going to invest against regulation. Said that, the whole AI mania has just 2 years. We are going to see 20 years of evolvement. Of development on this technology. Just think about that. Remember Internet 95, people were talking about Netscape. We are in 97, so now you're saying, oh my God, there is images in the browser. Oh my God, I can access some content, that database in the browser. That's where we are in AI today. So there is so many things to change, to evolve. We have to, many of you are in big companies here. I am now in a big, I'm a founder. I'm really a two people company founder, but now I'm also in a 30,000 people company. We have to remember, if you are a big company and you think life is going to be as it is today, bad news to you, you are in a big problem. Everything is going to change. Your business, specifically your business, I don't see the camera, but your business in the camera is going to change completely because you have a competitor running cheaper, faster, and better than you if you don't change. So, message to Europe, it's not my words. I read last week the prime minister or the president of Italy and France talking about how Europe is like a world, how can I say, is recognized by the quality of its regulation. However, the price of being over-regulating to reduce risk, in my opinion, is riskier than do not doing that. Because the world is changing very fast. If here in Europe, we are an European company, but with a global, we are South African, European, with investment in Asia, and a Brazilian CEO. So we are all around. The risk of over-regulating now in the first 2 years is stay behind. And I don't think Europe can stay behind. Europe has to lead in terms of efficiency, services. Obviously, with ethical behavior of technology.
How do you ensure that?
We ensure that investing in people and knowledge, in education. We ensure that if in all schools that we have, people understand not only programming, but how AI works, what is a model, how they train that, how they avoid not only hallucination, but mistakes or some bias that are unacceptable. We have to understand. After we understand, we have to demand people to deliver high quality deliverables.
But that you're talking about self-regulation, and I hate to say it, but self-regulation hasn't worked in other parts of social media, for example.
Mm-hmm. I'm saying that if we don't invest enough to understand and make a very good use of the tool, we are going to get behind. Mm. So what I see many times is people, and sometimes the media also contribute to that, not you, but the rest of the media, saying, oh my God, life is going to work, the world is going to end in the next few months, how we are going to prevent this world domination. Let's talk about the important things. Many of the biggest companies in the world, they run better, the leader companies, because they are using AI systems. Can it be used for bad? For sure. The best way to avoid that, have good people locally here in London, but also in Europe, but also in Latin America and in India, that can make sure that the usage is good. And not saying, do not do it, because someone else is going to do it. Can be the California people, can be Beijing, but someone else is going to do it. Can we afford not give the education or the healthcare or the efficiency that it's possible now? And I think in 5 or 10 years, this discussion, do we trust AI? We'll see that as the discussion, do we trust a car? We have to trust the people driving the car. We have some process to make sure that those people are reasonable people and they behave well when they are driving a car. If they are not reasonable people, they go to jail or they don't drive a car. That's how we trust a car.
So for those that are in the audience saying, okay, yeah, I want to integrate generative AI within my business, I'm going to reskill my employee base. What has been the biggest blocker for you getting it out into the population of your consumers and your employees as fast as you'd like?
You. Well, I like this.
This tool.
The leaders. The leaders has to stop being the guy that say, or the woman that say, I'm going to invest $1 billion or $100 million, and be the person that leads using. Spend time understanding what is the technology. Spend time understanding that we are just starting. There is so much development ahead. They should lead. They should show how they use AI to be more productive, to distribute more. And the company will follow. Actually, the younger people, they don't even understand why we're having this discussion. They use ChatGPT or other things every day or week to study more. So leaders lead, showing what is a good usage of AI instead of just writing emails about how much you are investing on that.
You're going to invest in any more generative AI companies?
We are going to invest a lot. Prosus has a very big investment capacity, and we want to help the whole emerging market and growth markets to lead this new revolution happening right now. We can't afford to be out of that.
Fabrizio, it's been a joy speaking with you. Thank you very much indeed. Do give it up for Fabrizio Bluisi.
Thank you very much.